हेलो यार, ज्वाइंट ज्वाइंट।
बिल्कुल
भी कोई क्वेश्चन नहीं पूछ सकते। माय वांट अ मीटिंग नाउ। तू ही रिजॉल्व कर दे सारे क्वेश्चंस। तू कर सकता है, डेट भी तो दे सकता है। हेलो या आई एम देयर ऑन द प्लेटफॉर्म, सेम प्लेटफॉर्म।
गुड इवनिंग डॉक्टर मनीष।
हाय, गुड इवनिंग।
Seems you're using a laptop or a desktop today.
I'm using a laptop,
Yeah, it's
my
much
poor
better.
quality laptop.
But it's your video is absolutely clear.
चलो, थैंकफुली।
Nice. So, sir, you can discuss now what exactly questions you will ask to which doctor. So that would be better, I guess.
So I think I have only kept very simple. There's no slide set. I've not prepared any slide set.
हाँ,
So
not required, sir. Sir, Jagdish has sent me the questions which I had posted on the group. So,
yeah.
which question you are going to ask which doctor?
So I'll ask Dr. Satish and Dr. Michelle. Is it very specific that I have to ask somebody specifically about that? Means all questions, any question can be answered by any, or both of you can give your inputs for any of the question.
Yeah, I mean, Manish, my suggestion is you sort of direct the question again to either one of us, and then
Right.
if there is any additional points which we would like to make for every question, then the
Right,
second
right.
person can chime in. Otherwise,
Right,
what
right.
happens is both of us start answering at the same time, and then
I'll direct the question, but in case some point has been missed by the other person, then they can pitch in and say that I
yes,
like
yes,
that.
yes, yes. I think that will be better.
Yeah.
So, Saloni, you will go live by 5. Saloni?
Yes, I'll inform before going live. It'll just take a minute for me to stream it. So I will inform. 5:51, I will start.
इसमें घंटा लगेगा।
ओके, मतलब वी डोंट टू डिस्टर्ब यू।
नहीं नहीं इट्स ओके, बट वो अलाउड नहीं है बाहर से। वो इसलिए अलाउ किया था उसका क्योंकि उसका फ्री डोज था। नेक्स्ट टाइम दे विल नॉट अलाउ हिम। इज गेटिंग बट आफ्टर 9 डोजेस इट्स फ्री ना। वो वाला उसका फ्री डोज था तो वो अलाउ हो गया था। नेक्स्ट टाइम तो ही विल नॉट टेक इट ओवर देयर, ही विल टेक इट एट होम। क्योंकि वो वाला फ्री डोज था तो वो अलाउ हो गया। बीच में जो फ्री डोज आता है वो भी तो अलाउ करते हैं ना। तो दैट इज व्हाट दे डिडंट अलाउ हिम एलिफ था हॉस्पिटल। द बेस्ट वे इज टू टेक इट एट होम।
मतलब घर पे होने चाहिए वो।
मेरा बंदा आएगा वो कर देगा। ही विल चार्ज 8,000 रुपीज।
ओके, यू
कैन बाय इट फ्रॉम आउटसाइड। मीट मी 2 डेज बिफोर एंड देन आई विल गेट इट ऑर्गेनाइज्ड एट होम।
ओके। और सर उसका मतलब कॉस्ट वगैरह क्या आएगा पर्जी का?
मैं आपको नंबर दे दूंगा उसका। प्रतीक का नंबर है तो सही तुम्हारे पास?
और मतलब हम ड्यूटी जिससे हम कोऑर्डिनेट करते हैं।
हाँ, प्रतीक प्रतीक का नंबर प्रवेश से ले लेना। ही विल टेल यू कि व्हाट इज द एक्चुअल कॉस्ट टू द। यू कैन बाय बोथ द इंजेक्शंस फ्रॉम आउटसाइड। सपोज देन रिटेलर मार्जिन विल बी सेव्ड। डू इट एट होम, व्हाट इज द प्रॉब्लम?
मतलब पोर्ट में खोल। अच्छा, वो
वही पोर्ट का बस। तुम्हें फिर वो
आई विल बी गोइंग लाइव नाउ।
स्टिच कराना पड़ेगा।
या
ब्लॉक करके
आई
वो मैनिपुलेशन नहीं कर पाएगा। या आई एम ओके, आई एम ऑल सेट।
ओके। सो सर, यू कैन स्टार्ट बाय इंट्रोड्यूसिंग दैट योरसेल्फ एंड ऑनको.कॉम एंड लाइक यू द टॉपिक एंड द स्पीकर्स एंड देन यू कैन स्टार्ट विद द क्वेश्चंस एंड आई विल बी ऑन म्यूट ओनली। सो ओनली यू विल ओनली हैव टू टेक इट फॉरवर्ड सर।
या
ओके, सो वी आर गोइंग लाइव नाउ, यू कैन स्टार्ट।
So, a warm welcome to everyone. And I am Dr. Manish Singhal. I am a medical oncologist at Indraprastha Apollo Hospital. And on behalf of the Onco.com entire team, I take this session forward on bone and soft tissue tumors for public awareness. And we have got two experts from India, Dr. Michel Parekh and Dr. Satish Reddy. And Dr. Michelle, very good evening to you.
Good evening, sir.
And Dr. Satish, very good evening to you also.
Good evening, Manish.
So we know that this is a public awareness platform, which is an initiative of Onco.com. And so the purpose over here is to resolve the frequently asked questions and queries among people about the bone and soft tissue tumors. So I'll start with Michelle. Michelle, can you just highlight that what do we mean when we talk of bone and soft tissue tumors? Which are the most common tumors that affect, that are enlisted in these in this bone and soft tissue tumors?
Sir, usually the bone tumors or bone and soft tissue tumors, we are mostly talking about...
Dr. Michelle, you'll have to be louder.
Okay. What I said is that when we talk about bone and soft tissue tumors, we are actually talking more about sarcomas. Like bone tumors are usually called sarcomas. And those of the connective tissue in the soft tissue are also called sarcomas. So the commonest bone sarcomas that we come across is osteosarcoma, sarcoma, and chondrosarcoma. And
you're losing your voice in between.
Can you hear me now?
Yeah, you have to be a bit louder, I think.
Okay. So what I'm saying is that the common bone sarcomas are osteosarcoma, Ewing sarcoma, and chondrosarcoma. And in soft tissue sarcomas, we have a huge variety, you know, 70-75 subtypes, high-grade pleomorphic sarcomas, nanodial sarcoma, and you know, we have soft tissue osteosarcoma in sarcoma as well.
Okay. Okay, thanks. So basically what it means is that either the bone tumors or the soft tissue part tumors, which arise either from the muscle or the fat of the body, and these are the sarcomas. So the mesenchymal tissue, we call them mesenchymal tissues, which from the tumors which arise from this. So Dr. Satish, sir, what are the common ages, you know, where you encounter bone tumors and soft tissue sarcomas?
Most of the bone tumors are actually found in the second decade of life. That means 10 to the age of 20. That's when you see one big chunk of people presenting with bone tumors. And then the second chunk of people who find is the above the age of 60, the elderly population again. Even though the majority of them may be metastasis to start with, but the second big chunk is above the age of 60. So these are the two extremes in which you find most of the bone tumors. And then you can have some bone tumors happening in between the age. It's not that you can't have any bone tumors between 20 and 60, but the numbers are less. And you see mostly benign tumors which are presenting to us in the intermediate age group.
Right. So mostly these tumors, what we gathered from here is affect the younger population, unfortunately. And so, I think one of the major things, Dr. Satish, is that many people think that tumors and cancers cannot happen in childhood.
Children, yes.
So they are many a times they are mistaken. That this ye to kuch aur hoga, this must be something else, and people don't take notice, and cancer as a diagnosis doesn't come to their mind.
True.
Whereas we must realize that bone tumors actually happen in younger age group as compared to the older age group, whereas sarcomas, that is soft tissue sarcomas, which arise from muscles and other, occur in younger as well as middle as well as older age group also. So Dr. Michelle, I'll come back to you again. So what are the common symptoms of these tumors so that, you know, the children are picked up early? So just for the understanding of everybody, we can just highlight that what are the common symptoms where a parent should become alert that this can be something and needs medical attention?
So what I feel is that a swelling in or around the joints or on the bone or, you know, in the muscles, which doesn't seem to have a reason that, you know, you cannot relate to a significant trauma. And that swelling could be painful, could be painless, it depends. Sometimes it is highly painful, sometimes it gradually becomes painful from being a painless swelling to begin with. So what I feel is that a swelling which you cannot account for by any trauma is something that should raise the alarm that I am looking at, I am, you know, dealing with something that could be a bone or soft tissue tumor. And especially in children, what we have seen is that trivial trauma, and then that brings our attention towards that swelling. And, you know, sometimes they get an x-ray done just because that swelling is not going away, or then it starts paining. And then it brings us to the diagnosis of a bone or a possible bone tumor. I would stress on the fact that a swelling which is out of proportion for the type of trauma or even without trauma and gradually increasing in size without any reason and pain or painless, it could be either way.
Right. I think, Dr. Mishal, you have very correctly put it that many times I'll remember from my old days when I was doing my DM that many children used to come with huge swellings and they used to account that swelling to a minor trauma. We all know that a minor trauma will not result into a huge swelling. It will be so very painful. Even a small swelling, even smallest trauma which causes swelling is generally very painful. And these tumors are usually less painful. So swelling is out of proportion to the pain is generally what is seen. So any swelling which is not accounted for by the amount of trauma, you have to apply your logical mind that this is something which cannot happen because of trauma. Trauma has to be with pain and swelling. These are usually very low trauma, bahut choti si chot, but swelling kahin zyada hai, bahut, the swelling is much bigger or much more lasts much more longer than after the trauma. Usually, chot lagne ke baad agar swelling hoti hai, it lasts a few days and it subsides. This swelling will not subside, and that should alarm the parents that needs a medical attention.
So, thumb rule which we can mention here is for especially for soft tissue sarcomas, anything which is deeper to the superficial skin and fat, and anything which is larger than 5 centimeters. These are two simple rules which anybody can remember. We have to suspect a sarcoma or a tumor until unless proved otherwise.
Unless until proved otherwise. So, Dr. Satish, can you just add more that what other things one can do or for early detection?
See, early detection from a perspective of patients or parents or caregivers is the one is to have a heightened level of suspicion in case something is not normal. You know, that is the most important thing. And many a time we do see parents coming and telling us that he hit the bench and then the swelling appeared and he's been going on with it for the last couple of months with that. But any trauma which doesn't subside usually in about a week, 10 days time, and there is rest pain, and this pain is disturbing their sleep, and then the swelling is gradually growing in size. A traumatic swelling will actually come down or stay the same. It doesn't continue to grow in size. So if there's a swelling which is growing in size, so these are the pointers for them to think otherwise, and they should approach a medical practitioner as quickly as possible after that.
So Dr. Mishal, I'll come back to you again. Sometimes patients, they come with a complaint that we went to the healthcare expert and they said, kuch nahi hai, kuch nahi hai. And they just shunned us away. And sometimes they didn't even get an X-ray done and gave some medication and see now this has happened. So what are the investigation that must be asked for when a swelling like this that we just mentioned comes to us?
To start with, a simple plain radiography is more than enough in 80 to 90% of the times to detect that something abnormal is going on. It may not necessarily be a tumor, but you can definitely pick out an abnormality. And if it is not bony, and if you feel the swelling is significant, the bone is looking absolutely normal, then get a sonography at least, to see if there is anything in the soft tissue that is looking like a space-occupying lesion. So basic tests like X-ray and sonography, I think, are good enough to start with to take you ahead for diagnosing these kind of tumors.
Right. So what we understood is a simple X-ray which doesn't put you at any risk of radiation exposure or anything is the bare minimum investigation which is required. Dr. Satish.
Yeah.
Right, sir. Sir, what other thing in case the X-ray has been done and it did not reveal much because X-ray, we know that the sensitivity of an X-ray is slightly lower and the swelling is not going, then what is the next investigation?
If you have an X-ray which has not revealed much, but clinically the suspicion is still high, or if the X-ray is again suspicious but not revealing its true nature, I think the best alternative which will help us in understanding what is happening around a soft tissue or a bone tumor, the next one is an MRI scan. And a magnetic resonance imaging will give us 90% of the information which is required. And for further management or for further steps which need to be taken, this will be of great use. So that would be my next port of action. And in case the MRI is positive for a tumor, then depending on the tumor, I would then think in terms of a technetium 99 bone scan or a PET scan or a CT scan. Depending on the tumor, we would look at it, you know, in different aspects.
Right. So that's the latest story. Once the suspicion has been engraved and it's very, very high in a, on a MRI. So the things to learn is that MRI is perhaps the best investigation to rule out a problem. In case the problem is not subsiding and X-ray is not very suggestive either ways, then the MRI is the best investigation. So another common question which comes to the mind of, you know, usual people and general people is, what can we do to prevent it? And children have hardly done anything which will put them at risk of having a grave disease like cancer. So it is not related to smoking. It is not related to anything. Are there any risk factors, Dr. Mishal? I'll ask this question. And I think the knowledge of risk factors will also make us understand what can we do for prevention. So risk factors and prevention. Are there any risk factors and are there any preventive strategies?
So what I feel is that, you know, these tumors happen to these children for no fault of theirs. You know, it is not like other carcinomas which can be attributed to a particular set of habits that you have developed during your growing age. These are children who have, you know, barely understood life and they suddenly have a swelling. I don't think there is a reason for this to happen at large. And hence, because we do not have any specific reason, I don't think we can do anything to prevent it from happening. All we can do is detect it early. And risk factor as well, what we can attribute it at a larger scale is that maybe somebody who has had cancer or a sarcoma in the family, there are some hereditary diseases that, you know, can make the parent or the caregiver or the physician a little bit more on the worrisome side that, okay, this child could have a, you know, sarcoma if such features are seen early, and then they can pick it up early and neglect it like, you know, some trivial thing that is happening. So I would say risk factors, yes, some hereditary diseases, but the prevention, I don't think that I have anything in mind that we can do to prevent.
Right. I think you have very rightly put it. Dr. Satish, would you like to add anything to this?
I 100% agree with Dr. Mishal when you say you have no preventive measures as such. But the only area where we can be made, the people can be made aware and some sort of an early action can be taken is the so-called secondary sarcomas. For example, if you have a multiple osteochondroma and there is a heightened risk of developing into chondrosarcoma, a proper education to the caregiver to be given to for them to understand that when do you start suspecting something has gone wrong. So in those secondary sarcomas, which are very small in number, we could try and educate them to intervene early if and when something goes wrong.
Right. So one very important message has come out of this, that there is no such risk factors and there are no such prevention of sarcomas and of bone tumors. There is hardly anything that one can do. Yes, there are certain syndromes which are familial cancers where there is a very strong family history of not only sarcomas or bone tumors but many other type of tumors, but thankfully such syndromes are rare and we don't have a lot of such patients who come as syndromic cancers, but usually there is no risk factors and usually there is nothing that one can do to prevent it. Now we will quickly come to the next phase of our discussion, that is, what are the treatments for these tumors? And I will ask my expert, Dr. Satish, that, sir, how do you approach a patient of a young patient of bone tumors? What is the treatment paradigm like in very simple words? And what is the general dictum of therapy?
The one really important point which I would like to make here is the process of arriving at the diagnosis itself. You know, first and the foremost thing is that you need to exhaust all your non-invasive methods of investigation, get as much information as possible about the tumor, and arrive at a diagnosis practically which only just needs confirmation by a biopsy. Otherwise, most often, you should be able to arrive at a diagnosis which is nearly 90-95% confident that this is the tumor. That's number one. And once you have exhausted all these things, there is a tendency for many people to jump into a biopsy, which we should avoid. We will do a biopsy only once all these are done. Now, the biopsy should be done by the person who is going to eventually complete the treatment aspect again, because the planning of the surgery has to happen in such a way that the biopsy also is part of the surgery. Very often, if you see the patients who could have had their limb salvaged get compromised by improper biopsies. So this is one aspect which everybody should be made aware, that biopsy and the final treatment should be done by the same person. Now, coming to the treatment per se, most of the tumors, we will be giving a course of chemotherapy, that is medicines, followed by surgery, and you will continue chemotherapy after the surgery is also over, depending on the tumor we are dealing with. Some of them are not chemosensitive, maybe we would have to give radiation. So the alternatives available with us are chemotherapy, surgery, and radiation, depending on the tumor. But very often it is a mixture of at least two of them, if not all three of them.
Right. Right. So very important thing came out of this discussion, that biopsy is imperative to reach a diagnosis. So, Dr. Michel, do you find any resistance in people about, or in patients about getting a biopsy done? Because usual thought process is that biopsy can lead to spread of the disease and things like that. Do you encounter this problem in your practice?
Yes, yes. So almost you can say half of the population has this myth that a biopsy causes spread of the cancer, or it increases the rate at which it is growing. And we like to, you know, explain it to them that if the needle biopsy done correctly, there is no harm or there is no risk of any spread or contamination of the tumor. Neither does it really, you know, increase the speed or rate at which it is growing. And even so, even if that happens sometimes that we irritate that tissue and it starts growing too much, but by the time the biopsy report is out and we are going to start the treatment, so there is no reason to worry, and always get the biopsy done. And like Dr. Satish mentioned, that, you know, that is the first step towards your management, and a biopsy will give us the tissue diagnosis, which will help us determine what chemotherapy to give, what to plan as the surgery, etc. And a rightly done biopsy will lead to limb salvation in most of the cases.
Right. So there is one question in the chat box, but we will take that question later on because that's a part of our discussion. So it is very important that a biopsy is done. Now, coming back to Dr. Satish, sir, how do you stage these cancers, and what are the different stages, simply put?
See, simply the most important thing we would like to understand is if the tumor is localized to one compartment, meaning that it is surrounded by, usually the limbs have compartments where it is covered by areas of tough tissue, what we call fascia. So we would like to understand if this is in one compartment or not. And the second thing which we would like to understand is it spread anywhere else? You know, other parts of the same bone or other faraway parts of the body? These are the two simple, to put it simply, these are the two things we would like to understand, which will help us in determining the kind of treatment a person can receive. The other important thing is, you know, their occurrence. Some of the tumors can occur in what we call the cubital fossa or the popliteal fossa. That means the joining of the thigh and leg, or the forearm and the arm. And then these automatically tend to be called extra compartmental. So the treatment again varies drastically from what is part of a compartment. So in bone and soft tissue tumors, these are the two things: which compartment, how many compartments, and has it spread anywhere else?
Right. So I think there are two important points which came out of this discussion. The one thing is that biopsy is important because your choice of therapy and everything else will depend on the type of biopsy that you do and the type of sarcoma that comes out to be. The biopsy that you do and the type of tumor that comes out to be. And the second part is that staging is important, and only after these two information that we can plan the therapy. Dr. Satish already highlighted one very important thing that the treatment is chemotherapy followed by generally surgery and followed by more chemotherapy. So now we will try to understand that what are the different chemotherapies for meant for this particular type of bone cancers and soft tissue sarcomas. And from Dr. Michel, Dr. Michel, can you just highlight that what is the importance of chemotherapy in bone tumors?
So with the advent of chemotherapy, you know, we could do more and more limb salvage procedures. And what chemotherapy does is it systemically attacks these cancer cells in the body. So for the common man, it is like injections that help, or medicines given via injection route that help reduce or kill the tumor burden in the body. Neoadjuvant chemotherapy given in bone tumors because it serves two purposes. One is gives us time to prepare for the type of limb salvage surgery that we want. Maybe, you know, we can take a proper measurement, get a customized prosthesis done if required. Or nowadays we have modular prosthesis, so we can, you know, plan our dissection accordingly. And in the meantime, we also understand how the biology of the disease is, how the patient is going to respond to this chemotherapy also helps us prognosticate this disease in the future. You know, like if we compare the pre-chemotherapy era, where, you know, even an amputation where the disease is completely taken out of the body, but the patient would not survive more than a couple of years because it comes back systemically. So chemotherapy has actually done wonders in the field of sarcoma, where we can do more and more limb salvage surgeries at the same time prevent its relapse or recurrence systemically. And the most important two type of bone sarcomas that we deal with is osteosarcoma and EV sarcoma. Luckily, both of them have a very good response to chemotherapy, the neoadjuvant as well as in the adjuvant setting. And the chemotherapy differs in both of them. And that, again, would depend on, you know, multiple factors, whether what is the best suitable regime for the patient, at the same time, what is the infrastructure in which we are going to be able to give the chemotherapy. So, yes, chemotherapy, neoadjuvant and adjuvant, both important in bone tumors, and it has helped the surgeon very much in achieving more and more limb salvage surgery.
Right. So chemotherapy is important, and chemotherapy has led to increase in cure rates of bone tumors and sarcomas, specifically in bone tumors. I would not be wrong in saying that with surgery alone, the cure rate of bone tumors used to be around 20%. And now with chemotherapy, the cure rate and surgery, the cure rates of bone cancers have increased to almost 60 to 75%. So Dr. Satish, sir, what usually people are very skeptical about bone tumors, that it may lead to amputation. Can you just tell us that what type of surgeries are usually done in these bone tumors, and what are the attempts of salvaging the limb and not sacrificing the limb? And does salvaging the limb decrease the cure rates or the treatment rates?
So limb salvage is actually not a new phenomenon. It has been now going on for last, I would say, around 40 to 50 years. And it is was in a nascent stage in our country. But today, if you go to any city in India, you will find at least a couple of surgeons who are doing limb salvage. That is number one. When we say limb salvage, what we are trying to do is we are trying to remove the part of the bone which has been damaged by the tumor and leave the limb which is below the tumor and above the tumor intact and replace it with an artificial prosthesis. So there are multiple varieties of prosthesis available which can be used for the patient depending on their age as well as the requirement. You know, you could actually replace the whole bone with the two joints, you can replace only the middle of the bone, you can replace only the joint, multiple things can be done. And also there are the implants which can be expanded. You could have an implant which can be expanded using an external device. You could maybe jack it up using a screw by doing a small surgery. So that as the patient grows, the implant also is going to match with the growth. And these are all available in our country and are being done on a regular basis with phenomenally good success rates. And this is translated from our expertise in doing joint replacement. So we are getting more and more expertise in doing these things. The second most important thing is in a well-done limb salvage, the cure rate or the reoccurrence rate is not affected because of the limb salvage. It is equivalent to an amputation. If you do an amputation or a limb salvage, the cure rate remains the same as long as it's done by a proper oncosurgeon. It depends on the way the tumor behaves as well as how sensitive the tumor was to the other adjuvant modalities of treatment like chemotherapy or radiotherapy. Now, I would like to just make a point for the common people who are listening that how chemotherapy works is that when we say cancer or a tumor, we are talking of cells which are alive. Basically, they are circulating in our blood system. They're going to different parts of the body. And these cells, if they get a conducive atmosphere to get attached somewhere, they get attached and grow again. It's because these are living cells. Now, these chemotherapy, whatever we are giving, kills these cells which are in the bloodstream so that they don't get attached anywhere else and start to grow again. This is a simple way to understand how chemotherapy helps in terms of killing the disease which is already circulating. At the same time, it reduces the size of the original primary tumor, helping us in doing a good limb salvage procedure.
Right. So, very important points. Just to reiterate them, that chemotherapy is important. The cure rates with chemotherapy has increased leaps and bounds because whenever a tumor develops, some cells, they leak into the circulation and they are not visible in the CT scan, PET CT scans, MRIs. They are just in the circulation. And the chemotherapy takes care of these cells, whereas surgery takes care of the local disease. So a combination of this therapy is the best. When you combine chemotherapy and surgery in some sequence or the other, the usual sequence is chemotherapy followed by surgery, followed by rest of the chemotherapy. So the chemotherapy takes care of these cells in circulation so that these cells do not find any conducive environment to settle down and start growing. And surgery takes care of the local disease. So Dr. Michel, what are the cure rates of these tumors, of these cancers when detected not very late but not very early also, but intermediate stage, that is the usual state in India. So what are the cure rates with chemotherapy and surgery that we just discussed?
So like you said, when it is, you know, in the intermediate stage during diagnosis, so let's say a tumor say around 5 to 8 centimeters in the bone, non-metastatic, no spread in the body, and we give neoadjuvant therapy, responds very well. We do a limb salvage surgery and then we give adjuvant therapy based on our necrosis and the other parameters. What I feel is that osteosarcoma patients, there is almost a 55 to 60% cure rate. In Ewing sarcoma patients, maybe even a radiation part is added in the adjuvant setting that has given a 65 to 70% cure rates. So on an average, bone sarcomas cure with the correct type of treatment that is given to them, we have almost 60% cure rates to be, you know, on an average side.
Right. So there was a question in the chat box, and I think this answers that question very well, that the cure rates of sarcomas, bone tumors and sarcomas, is in the tune of 60% if you have detected it fairly early before it spreads to any other part of the body. Dr. Satish, now coming to you, sir. Can stage 4, that means when cancer has spread to the other parts of the body, is there any cure in stage 4 sarcomas also?
See, theoretical possibility and special situations are available, but I would not do it as a generalization. Let us say there is an isolated metastasis, what we call an isolated metastasis, that is, you have a tumor which is primary, which is present, which you think is under control, you can control. And then there is another spread to one lobe of the lung, one specific part of the lung. And you could actually do a tumor treatment for the primary tumor as well as the lung at the same time. And you could get away maybe you could achieve a cure rate. But these are all very specific situations where we need to tailor the treatment. In general, stage 4 and where it is spread to the other parts of the body, the outlook is bleak.
Right. So it is very well said that even in stage 4, but specific stage 4, that means usually these bone tumors, they go to the lung, and if you have some isolated bone lung metastasis, there is a possibility of doing chemotherapy and surgery both to the primary, that is the lymph, and also to the lung. And in these specific scenarios, one can try to hit cure even in final stage of the disease. But as said earlier, that it is almost always necessary to detect them early and treat them early to get the best possible results. Now, coming back to Dr. Mishal, are there any new treatments which have come in bone and soft tissue sarcomas in general, and specifically the bone tumors?
So newer, advances would be, say, in terms of surgery. We have, like Dr. Satish mentioned, we have expandable implants. Like, we had a phase where, we had children who were not skeletally mature and not even attained that much of bone, bone height, that we could put a prosthesis, artificial joint, and we had to amputate them even when we could do a limb salvage for oncological clearance. So now, with this advancement of expandable mega prosthesis, even the smallest of the babies, we can put in, a prosthesis which we can expand with the growth of the child over the years, minimally invasive or with an external device, like sir mentioned. Secondly, what has come up new is, navigation. Navigation for, say, specifically pelvic tumors, which are a very complex anatomy. The reason is such that, where we sometimes fail to get adequate margins, or in attempt to get adequate margins, we fail to give them a good function. These navigation techniques have helped us, get enough adequate margins and retain enough adequate function. So, from my side as a surgeon, these are two very important things that have helped us do good surgeries and achieve good outcomes. And the third thing that is not very new, but it is relatively new in our country, cryotherapy, where you are going to remove part of the bone and subject it to liquid nitrogen and then put it back in the body with the help of screws and plates and rods, which gives us, the patient gets his own or her own bone back. Like, we used to do it as an extracorporeal radiotherapy, where a radiotherapy unit was necessary to be around or in the same institute, which caused a lot of infrastructural issues, because every hospital where you can do a limb salvage surgery may not have a radiation unit. You may not have a unit nearby because the patient is on operative table and it has to come back in time and put it back. So this cryotherapy has also helped achieve what you call as a biological reconstruction without having a very big infrastructure with you. So these three advancements in surgical field, I feel, have really helped us do more and more limb salvage surgeries with the limited resources that we have and still give the patient the best possible result.
So, Dr. Mishal, can you also, since you have already highlighted the various advancements in surgery, like expendable implants, where the child has not gained his full height, and you don't need to do a re-surgery, but you can put an expendable plant so the height can be attained, and the other things, that navigation and the liquid nitrogen treatment when putting the same bone graft back. What are the best centers to take, these type of, not to name the centers, but generally people get swayed by, different types of surgeons. So who is an ideal surgeon to do a bone surgery or a bone tumor surgery or a soft tissue sarcoma surgery? So what one should look up to?
Ideally, it should be somebody who is a trained and qualified orthopedic oncologist, musculoskeletal oncosurgeon, or a surgical oncologist who has got adequate exposure to bone and soft tissue sarcomas during training. And we have multiple institutes, Apex institutes, which have very good training in these type of, management of these type of surgeries. In terms of soft tissue sarcomas, I would say that because these are more in the extremities, somebody who has adequate knowledge about the anatomy of the extremities, the upper and the lower extremities, which most likely is an orthopedic surgeon, but also surgical oncologist well trained in that, can be or should be what the patient should target. A surgical oncologist trained in bone and soft tissue surgeries, or a musculoskeletal oncologist, an orthopedic surgeon who is then well trained in bone and soft tissue sarcoma surgeries.
Right. So I think this is a very important message. To get the best possible surgical outcome, it is important that the surgeon is well trained in ortho-oncology or musculoskeletal oncology or oncosurgery, or a surgical oncologist who is trained in bone and soft tissue sarcoma surgeries. So that is something which is important to get the best possible outcome. Not all surgeons are equipped to handle these type of complex surgeries. Dr. Satish, sir, any improvement or any new drugs that you are aware of, which or any new treatments in systemic treatment of bone cancers and soft tissues cancers? And again, I'll ask the second question, that who are the best equipped people to undertake chemotherapy?
I will not comment on the best drugs available, Dr. Manish. I think you should be the one commenting about it. And the medical oncologists are the right people to help us in getting through the pre and post-operative chemotherapy. So a couple of sentences from your side, you've been moderating really well, but a couple of sentences from your side would be useful in this.
Right. So so hardly any major, you know, new drug has come in. Of course, there are new chemotherapeutic drugs which have come in, but as such, soft tissue sarcomas and specifically bone cancers, they no such targeted therapies are available. So we are still using the same old protocols that we were using about 10 years back. And the success story is, you know, is around 70% of cure rates. So early detection remains very key. And I think the best people equipped to undertake chemotherapies are those who are well trained in chemotherapy, and they are medical oncologists who should be doing this type of systemic therapy of bone cancers. However, in soft tissue sarcomas, definitely some new therapies have come in, and we have been able to subdivide these soft tissue sarcomas much better. That means histopathological classification and molecular classification of sarcomas have been better understood by us over last one decade or so. Now we are able to segregate these sarcomas better into various subforms or molecular classifications. And we have been able to find certain targeted therapies which are effective in sarcomas, not bone cancers, but sarcomas, such as inflammatory myofibroblastic tumor. We know that they can be ALK positive, and certain drugs which are actually were effective in lung cancer have found to be effective in sarcomas also. Likewise, there are many other examples. GIST, that is gastrointestinal stromal tumor, there are a lot of new drugs which have come in. So we have been able to find certain targeted therapies to our use in sarcomas. But bone tumors which happen in early ages are generally dealt with the garden variety chemotherapy that we were using earlier. And early detection remains key. So there was one question in the chat box, that what are the treatments available? I think by and far, we are as at par with any international society or any international country where bone cancers are treated or soft tissue sarcomas are treated. We are at par with any international place where these tumors can be dealt with. And we are able to do a very good job, a very satisfactory job. Dr. Mishal, would you like to comment on this particular question? What are the treatments available in India, and are we doing a great job or not? Are you satisfied with what we are doing?
So I feel that India is at par, you know, with any other country in the world in terms of treatment of bone and soft tissue sarcoma. I mean, we may not have those implants or those kind of instrumentations that do the surgeon's job, but overall the patient never suffers. What we have individually developed, what we have in our country, is state-of-the-art implants last longer than the patient's life for sure. Chemotherapy agents, like you said, are standard and they do the right job in every aspect. And even today, radiation, we are coming up with, you know, good quality radiation which have least side effects. And we are also now coming with proton therapy, you know. So we are not lagging behind in terms of the quality of required in bone and soft tissue sarcomas as far as the rest of the world is concerned. Yes, we are still in the growing phase as a country and as a healthcare facility. We, you know, not very biased about the fact that we are very good, but yes, we are not less than most of the countries in the world, and our patients have equal cure rates as other patients in the Western countries. We have centers, you know, centers of excellence, they are high volume centers, and the research and the literature from every center in India is equivalent to the ones that are coming from the Western countries. So I would again stress on the fact that our patients are actually in the right hand. They just need to be a little more aware. They need to be proactive when you know they are faced with such a situation. And what we feel is that they should be positive and they should get the results that they want.
Right, right. Thank you very much. And Dr. Satish, your comments on how how do we fare in India as far as these cancers are concerned?
I think I agree with Dr. Mishal when we say we are on par with the rest of the world in terms of being able to give treatment to any kind of tumor which we have thrown at us. Even the implants, if with proper planning and guidance, we are able to procure most of the implants or at least the best quality implants available elsewhere in the world are available in India also. And the only thing which we need to actually look at in terms of trying to achieve better outcomes is instead of looking at the tumor availability of technology, I think we should look at patient education and doctor education, where we need to increase the awareness that about the tumor, about the treatment modalities available, and about being able to accept the occurrence of a tumor in a younger child, like what you mentioned at the beginning of the webinar. And then the being able to approach the right kind of doctors to be able to get the right kind of treatment. This awareness should be encouraged in the general public as well as in general doctors community.
Right. So that is exactly the point that I also try to make a point on it, that who are the right people who are equipped, right medical fraternity who are equipped to deal with such problems. One thing that we missed out is, how about rehabilitation? What are the facilities for rehabilitating these children and young adults who meet with a disease like this and have to undergo a transplant or a implant-based surgery? So what are the various rehabilitation programs which are available? And are there any support programs or support groups which exist? So Dr. Mishal, you can take this question. And then we'll ask the same question to Dr. Satish, because I think this is one of the most important and concluding questions that needs to be addressed.
So with the right medical treatment, with the right surgical treatment, it is a battle almost won, not completely won. So what we need is rehabilitation, like you rightly said. These are joints, these are limbs that undergo implantation and prosthetic changes. And they require good type of physiotherapy and occupational therapy for the functions to come back. Like we have mentioned always, that the multidisciplinary care, we have oncophysicians, oncosurgeons, radiation oncologists, psychiatrists, physiotherapists, everybody is involved. So the right type of physiotherapy helps to rehabilitate these patients better. And these are not very, difficult rehabilitations. They just begin be difficult to understand, but the moment the patient understands, say two or three sittings, and then they can do it themselves and come back with the functional outcomes that we expect from our surgeries. And the second part of the question is that hello, am I audible?
Yeah, you're audible. Your voice is breaking a bit, but you're audible.
Okay. So I forgot the second part of the question.
Any support groups or support programs?
There are multiple support groups. Usually, all area or regional support groups are there. Then there are support groups within the institute as well, where they have their survivors, where they have their patients who are ongoing treatment. And then they have patients who are just diagnosed and who are in all the dilemmas of how the treatment is going to be. So we do have a very, very strong support group system from institute to institute and state to state, where a patient and the caregiver themselves act as a very good source of inspiration and motivation to the newer patients, as well as with good support from the medical fraternity, right from the financial, advisor till the surgeon and the top-notch physicians. That the support system in our country, I feel, is really good. The awareness is increasing in the last 5 years. That is what I experienced myself. And I feel as a country, we are on the right track towards a good treatment for sarcomas.
Right, thank you. Dr. Satish, your comments on the same thing, rehabilitation, and what about the support groups and support programs that exist?
Yeah, rehabilitation, the one of the most important things which in my personal experience I have noticed is that these are some of the patients we need to spend more time as a surgeon with. You know, you need to be able to sit down, have a chat with them, not only talk about medicine, you know, inquire into their personal lives, see how they're doing, how is your school going, how is your job going, you know, those kind of things actually help us connect better, and they come out with all their small problems, nitty-gritty things which we can help. That is one thing. And then unlike other surgeries here, they actually lose a fair chunk of their muscle or one part of their mobility system. So we would definitely need to be a little more aggressive in terms of physiotherapy, but at the same time, you know, we need to be there along with them, along with the physiotherapist and the psychologist or a psychiatrist to help them motivate and talk to them. And these are the kind of people whom we need to listen to and talk to more than anything else, I think. And that will take them through most often. And what I also noticed is whenever we need support in terms of, we're trying to encourage them, putting them one-on-one with a couple of patients who have had this kind of, gone through this kind of a thing before, actually really gives them a bucket load of confidence. And most often, patients who we approach say, there is a patient of mine, would you like to be able to talk to them? And they're all willing to talk because they've gone through this whole rigmarole and this whole traumatic experience. They're always willing to help. And if you get them to sit across each other and have a chat with them, you ask them to come to the hospital just to talk to a particular patient, they're always willing. So if you can get them face to face with a couple of patients, then they get a lot of confidence. This is what I noticed. So most often I get one of my old patients to come in. My oldest patient survivor is now around 20 years since I've operated on. So he's married, he's got kids, and he's doing a job. So you get him and make him sit with a patient who's just had a diagnosis of an osteosarcoma. Imagine the kind of morale boost that that patient gets. So this is the most important thing which we can do, I feel.
That's most gratifying. I think we have come to an end of this wonderful session, and I'd like to just, you know.
Manish, we lost your voice. Manish, we're not able to hear you. Not able to hear you, Manish. Try now. No, you're not audible. Yeah, Manish, you're not audible. Let me conclude this on the behalf of the team. In the meanwhile, Manish, if you don't mind, if you can try to log off and join in again, and let's see if that will help us. That will be very useful, I think. So I would like to thank Onco.com for giving us this opportunity to talk about bone and soft tissue tumors. I think we've had a very fruitful and informative discussion, I would say, wherein majority of the points in regards to treatment of bone and soft tissue tumors have been covered. And I hope this will be a useful conversation which somebody can play again and listen to in case they have any doubts. And I would like to congratulate Dr. Mishal and Dr. Manish for this wonderful interaction. Thank you, Onco.com. And I hope if Manish can try and rejoin, let's see if he can join. Manish?
Yeah, hi.
Yeah, back. Welcome back.
I don't know what.
Oh, we lost you again.
You lost me again. I think some connectivity issue is there.
Yeah, your voice is coming, but as if it is in slow motion. So I think that's okay. I think we can end the session.
Thank you. Thank you very much, everybody.
Thank you, Manish.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.